This is Nine News with Lizzie Pearl.
Good morning. The first of the Hunter Valley bus crash victims is being laid to rest this morning. Friends and loved ones of 28-year-old Angus Craig are right now gathering to farewell him at a service in Nowra on the New South Wales south coast. Attendees are being asked to make a donation to a cancer charity in lieu of flowers. Memorials for the nine other victims are expected to be held over the coming weeks, and we will have more on this story from our reporter a little later in the bulletin. Russian President Vladimir Putin is still yet to be seen or heard from after he was forced to cut a deal with a leader of a short-lived rebellion to end the uprising. Our Europe correspondent Brett McLeod has the details.
Vladimir Putin's strongman leadership has forever been undermined by those extraordinary sequence of events that played out over the weekend. Perhaps just as extraordinary that ever since the rebellion was stopped, Vladimir Putin has been silent, no public announcements. There was an interview that he had apparently pre-recorded before the uprising started. Also, no sign of Yevgeny Prigozhin, the man who led that uprising, the head of the Wagner private military group, who said as he got closer to Moscow, he would pull back to avoid further bloodshed and instead go to Belarus in apparent exile. But again, too, for a man who's been very public in his announcements and criticisms of the Kremlin, nothing. So that, of course, leads to much speculation about whether there is now a power vacuum at the top or whether there'll be now more rebellions and uprisings. The United States watching very closely.
This has been a devastating strategic failure for Putin across virtually every front, economic, military, geopolitical standing. And this really is fundamentally an internal matter for the Russians. We're seeing it unfold. Again, we saw the rising tensions over several months that led to this, but exactly where this goes, we don't know.
Also talking about the events in Russia, its neighbour Ukraine and Vladimir Zelensky talking to US President Joe Biden. Mr. Zelensky tweeting out that we discussed the course of hostilities and the processes taking place in Russia. The world must put pressure on Russia until international order is restored, because that may wait until order is restored in the Kremlin.
Tributes are pouring in for Labor figure Simon Crean, who died suddenly while on a business trip to Germany. Crean was the federal Labor leader from 2001 to 2003 while the party was in opposition. He also played a key role in the union movement. In a statement, his family said he passed away after his morning exercise in Berlin, where he was staying as part of an industry delegation. He was 74. Full-time workers on the minimum wage are barely making ends meet, with new data revealing the extent of Australia's cost of living crisis. For the details, let's go to federal politics reporter Ashley Wick in Canberra. Ash, how bad is it?
Lizzie, people on low incomes are living close to, if not on, the poverty line. Anglicare's Living Costs Index shows how the minimum wage stacks up against everyday essentials. It shows full-time workers are struggling with the soaring cost of living and many are forced to make sacrifices. Now, these people work across industries like retail, food, the care industry, such as aged care workers. A full-time worker on the minimum wage is left with just $57 after weekly expenses. A family of four with two parents on the minimum wage has $73 left over. And a single parent can't cover basic expenses. They're estimated to fall short $180 every week. Now, rent is the biggest financial stressor, followed by food and transport. As the cost of these essentials soar, Anglicare says more people are turning to agencies like theirs for support.
We also need to ask ourselves really seriously what kind of a society we've built that's got us to a stage where people working full-time in occupations that we need can't afford to put a roof over their family's head.
Some of the federal government's cost of living relief takes effect from this Saturday, that is July 1. Now, those measures include cheaper childcare and changes to paid parental leave. Electricity bill relief of up to $500 for low-income households is on the way, but for many, power prices will rise further. Aged care workers will also get a 15% pay rise. Now, Labor says these measures, they are targeted. They're relief that balances the challenge of high inflation against the soaring cost of living. Lizzie.
Ashley Wick there in Canberra. New South Wales police have uncovered a stash of cash and two firearms after arresting six men over a brawl in Sydney's CBD last Wednesday. Police allege the fight was sparked by a power struggle within an organised crime network and have issued a warning to all full-time criminals.
We've got powerful legislation, we've got a powerful team, and, you know, it's almost impossible for them to continue their operations here in New South Wales.
The six men arrested are said to be associated with the Alamedine crime clan. Duchess of York Sarah Ferguson has revealed she's recovering from surgery after a breast cancer diagnosis. The 63-year-old was diagnosed with an early form of the cancer detected during a routine mammogram. A spokesperson said the surgery was a success and her prognosis is good. A memorial is being held this morning for a young man who died in the Hunter Valley bus tragedy, the first of several funerals to be held over the coming weeks. Damien Ryan is there.
Many of the mourners here today for the funeral of 28-year-old engineer Angus Craig, well, 15 days ago, were all together celebrating the wedding of Mitchell and Maddie Gaffney in the Hunter Valley. Mitchell and Maddie are here present for this morning's service, along with many, many people. Mitchell and Angus were once housemates in Singleton. Of course, this tragedy has been well told. A fairy tale wedding ceremony in the Hunter Valley, a reception, and then 35 guests on a bus which crashed on a roundabout near Singleton. Of course, 10 people were killed in that crash, and this is the first of those 10 funerals. On Wednesday, young doctor Beck Mullen will be farewelled in her hometown, Singleton, and of course there will be other funerals in coming weeks in Tasmania, Melbourne and Sydney.
We have some breaking news now, and the High Court has dismissed an application from Russia to prevent the Commonwealth retaking land at the centre of a messy diplomatic dispute. Let's go live to Eliza Edwards, who is at the High Court. Eliza, tell us, what did the court find?
Well, Lizzie, High Court Justice Jane Jago found the case put forward by Russia was weak. The country had been seeking to prevent the Commonwealth from retaking a parcel of land adjacent to Parliament House that was supposed to be the site of a second Russian embassy until the government passed legislation to tear up Russia's lease for the site on national security grounds. Now, as a sign of how messy this dispute has become, a Russian embassy employee has essentially been squatting on the site for the past week. The High Court's decision today paves the way for the government to retake possession of the site and kick off this squatter. Now, Russia may decide to launch another High Court challenge, Lizzie, but for now, this is a win for the government.
Eliza Edwards there in Canberra. After ongoing issues with overseas-made ferries in Sydney's west, the state government has come up with a solution. Liz Daniels has the details.
Seven new ferries are now officially on order from just across the Bass Strait. A Tasmanian company has been tasked with building the new vessels, which will replace these ageing Rivercat ferries that have been servicing Parramatta for nearly 30 years. The Premier saying it is the first step towards building here in New South Wales. The most recent ferry purchase for Parramatta, the River-class vessels, have been plagued with problems. They were built overseas.
After the last 5 years of real turmoil when it comes to ferries in New South Wales, with overseas built transport infrastructure that hasn't worked, we're announcing a change in strategy from the New South Wales government.
New vessels are going to see some 73 changes. We won't see any asbestos anymore. We will see safety issues fixed, and we'll see them built in Australia, something that's desperately overdue.
It was impossible for the government to award a New South Wales-based contractor to build these vessels because there simply was no bid. They have been designed here, though, on the northern beaches. And the Premier's already eyeing his next transport purchase, a fleet of new trains, which he says can be built right here in New South Wales.
1 week on from the Titan submersible's doomed mission, authorities from the US and Canada are conducting multiple investigations into the cause of the implosion. US correspondent Lauren Tomasi has the latest.
Debris recovery is now the focus of this operation as the US Coast Guard, along with their Canadian counterparts, work to retrieve what is left of the Titan submersible from the ocean floor. Leading that operation is the Asidius 6000, a remotely operated machine which has now travelled to the area around the Titanic wreck four times, retrieving pieces of that submersible and mapping the ocean floor. The US Coast Guard has today confirmed its highest level of investigation has been launched as the agency moves away from search and rescue and into retrieval.
The Coast Guard doesn't charge for search and rescue, nor do we associate a cost with human life. We always answer the call. And so the ocean remains an unforgiving environment, and every weekend there are risks that are taken as people go to the water with inadequate safety gear.
It's been 1 week since the Titan submersible departed on its doomed mission to the wreck of the Titanic, the vessel losing communications 1 hour and 45 minutes into its descent, almost 4 kilometres on the ocean floor. We now know it suffered a catastrophic implosion, killing all five people on board. The Titan's mothership, the Polar Prince, is now back in port in Canada, where further investigations are unfolding. Canadian police have confirmed they are looking into the incident, and the Transportation Safety Board of Canada boarding that vessel to interview those on the ship and confirming it's carrying a vital piece of evidence.
Vessels of this size are required to have a voyage data recorder, which records audio that's on the bridge. The content of those voice recordings could be useful in our investigation, but the contents are privileged under Canadian law, and therefore I can't share, or we can't share what the voice recordings will say.
When it comes to potential lawsuits in this incident, the US Coast Guard has confirmed it will make its recommendations at the conclusion of its investigation.